So you're going to get a close to what I'm talking about because it says automated networks up there. But you know, here's the world we live in. I bet there's not a single person here that isn't entirely reliant on Wi-Fi in some point, some way in their world. Probably too reliant. I mean, it's like we've become addicted to it. You know, if we can't get it at home, we're looking for it outside. And if we can't do it on our mobile phone. So we're in a space that is touching so much and is growing day by day. The amount of connected people in the world is just off the hook. And then you have the other dimension of all of these IoT devices, the Internet of Things devices, which are all speaking on this. So I feel I'm in a really exciting place in terms of technology. But there's a problem. There's ugly words up there. When you're running a business and someone says, either you say it to yourself, that's weird, I can't connect. Or you're in an office environment. I used to work at Hewlett Packard. You know, the first thing is people stand up at the cubicle and say, can you connect? And then you say, no. Hey, Mark, can you connect? It's just a disaster. So what we're going to go after is a place that actually takes this to be an even rarer activity, where people and their networks can't connect. The reason it's so important is cloud everything. So in terms of your technologies, everyone is on cloud services. If people do not have some cloud infrastructure in their world, then they're stuck in the early 90s. You know, having it on your premise, on a server, is increasingly the bad way to go. So if you're not connected, you're not getting to email, you're not running your HR systems, you're not getting revenue, you're not checking your bank balances. So for business to be able to connect and do it securely, critically important. Same way with time intolerant. We don't have a nanosecond to live anymore. We have to have it done right now. Gartner's done some interesting analysis. Businesses, $42,000 an hour for downtime. Smaller business, less. Bigger business, a bigger number. So it's critically important. So what happens when you're sitting here watching this little thing on your spin around? That means money. Money is being lost when that happens. And I show you some of the examples. Is first off, you know, you ask each other. Then someone says, "Does IT know?" And you go down this kind of laundry list. And then you get to this question: well, is there an internet provider, or is it our Wi-Fi or on our network? And that's that ugly demarcation point where they say, "Oh well, that's just my point and not the other point." So that's a really important thing to figure out. Then people say, well, let's try rebooting it. And the story goes on. Finally, this is the worst thing. You say, well, forget this, I'm going to go home. That's not good for business. We're going to bring a different world. Our world is about automating this. So all of the stuff I just described, that's what a guy in IT does. That's what someone is doing. So in our vision of the world, we're going to actually take action immediately because it's going to be monitoring. It's going to be watching, am I connected out there to the cloud services? Then it's going to automate the troubleshooting. The thing that the IT guy would do, it's going to start instantaneously. It's going to run through routines. It's going to review. It's going to check all those kind of things. Then it's going to tell people and say, hey, we checked. And by the way, this is a Comcast issue. We got a ticket into them. We'll update you. Finally, people can figure out what to do. Then you get access. So when you have real deep technology people, they can get access. It doesn't matter whether it's here in this building, whether it's downtown Sacramento or in Tokyo. I can access it. I just actually set up a guest network here on demand. So we can reach out to these places in real time, just like you're there. And insightful analytics, we want to be able for you to be able to prove to your internet provider that they're basically lousy. It keeps going down. Or that you need more bandwidth, or that your infrastructure needs updating. So real data, not just the emotional feel, but it's not any good. We have a complete system. We already have cloud-managed Wi-Fi. One of this box up here, that's Tallac. That's one of our Wi-Fi devices. We have thousands of these around the world that are doing it. We have Ethernet switches. We have models about buying direct and pay monthly. Give you an idea, it starts around $40 a month for some very basic services. A bit more about it. So we started back in 2012. A lot of us came from Hewlett Packard down the road here. A lot of folks from some leaders in software-defined networking. We're located here, very proud of it that we're here in the US. We're privately owned and funded. We've had investors from a hardware company that we use and some local investors around here, which has been very good. We've got massive amounts of experience. That was one of the greatest things that I enjoy about our company. We have some very deep technology experts. We've written books about software-defined networking. We have the PhD guys, which are just awesome. You know, just ask them a question and you get more of the information than you need. We currently have nearly 4,000 devices actually currently on our cloud. We have a major OEM, I'll talk about that in a second, which is a person using it. And we consider ourselves leaders in SD. So if you see SD in the world, software defined. It means you write the instructions on the cloud and it tells stuff what to do. that's this new era. You'll see software-defined WAN, wide area network, local area network, software-defined everything. And of course, patents are important. The paths to success, let me just go our core values. So some of the things that we have around here is we are customer-led. Okay, so if a customer doesn't need it, we don't go build it. That's really, really important. We collaborate with other companies, and we have this will to win, and I think that's what, why we're all here. We have a will to win. The three areas that we're going after to really get to this market, because it's a big market out there, the total enterprise land space is about $25 billion. This software-defined or cloud stuff is about $6 billion in 2021. So we're going after new investors. We actually meet with folks in the Bay Area quite regularly, Sand Hill. We actually are partnering with software-defined WAN companies because there's a natural coming together of these systems that they need. And we also have private label, the OEM world, where there are big technology partners out there that don't have this. They need it, they come to us, we put their label on it, you wouldn't know the difference. And again, that's what gets us to be scale. And as I say, this is kind of where we're headed. We are predicting some fairly big growth. We have big ideas about how we want to get there. And that concludes me. Thank you.
So the first question, as always, is how can we help you?
Absolutely. That's a really good question. I'm glad you get the prime on that one. So, so a couple of things is local investors, if you're talking to people out there, if you can share the information, share the concept about what we're trying to do, it is kind of big. We would love to find additional local investors or people that may touch this kind of technology because we think it is really interesting and there's some very important market dynamics that are going on. I didn't get in the deck here. But the SD-WAN, software-defined WAN, essentially what that is, it allows companies to use low-cost internet connections from Comcast, AT&T, and they're creating this overlay on the internet. So the internet is now being meshed with these virtual services, and over $500 million has been put in by venture capitalists to do this. So they're kind of rewriting the way we do networking, and we are one of the few companies in that space that will be logically acquired. So we are pretty excited that we are going to get to some interesting places. So investors is really important. The other thing, if you know people that have branch offices, I wouldn't recommend our stuff if you actually just have your own home office. It's kind of cool, but you don't really need the licensing because you're there. But if you have someone who has multiple sites, so when you start to grow and you have places around the country, come talk to us. We would love to put our equipment with you guys and have you show it to other people. So that's another thing is where we can place equipment where you have multiple locations.
Great. Any other questions?
Go for it.
What do you guys do to address the security concerns around IoT and Wi-Fi, that sort of thing?
Absolutely. This is an area that people don't think about, and I'm glad you brought that up. So typically we have Wi-Fi, and off it goes, we put a password on it, and we connect everything to that Wi-Fi. Okay, but it's like putting it all in one big bucket. And so what we're saying now is divide your bucket up. You have a portion of your network for voice over IP traffic, and that's the highest priority. You have a portion for your business users. You have a bit for your guest network. And now create a place for your IoT devices. Because what happens in this denial of the DDoS attacks is these little IoT devices, they start attacking things that will go into things that they shouldn't do. And when you can actually isolate them on a segment of your network, they certainly can't start to bother your laptops, your other equipment. So our story is about creating secure virtual networks. In this building, that one is now creating three virtual secure networks, all separated, so you can put these devices on their own separate world and they can't interfere. But it's so easy to do, it takes like less than a minute.
Yeah.
So. Go for it, yeah.
Are you making most of your money with basic software packages, or do you do more customization? Or depending upon your clients, and that goes back to who are your focus clients? Are they small, medium, or are they larger corporations?
So typically small, medium with multiple branch offices is the sweet spot.
Okay.
Think about chains of restaurants, for example, like a Carl's Jr. where you might have thousands of locations and you don't want to have IT people in each state because you can do it centrally. We would prefer to be in that kind of branch office space than the large corporate building of 3,000 people. you know, it does work, but in terms of, you know, staff focused in an area, it is that. We are actually more focused now on scaling through partnering with OEM companies that need these kind of services, or joining the software-defined WAN people as part of their solution, because the sheer cost of setting up a Salesforce, you know, that's one of the things, cost of customer acquisition, subcutting it. So we actually are trying to get to the point where in that $3 to $5 million plus dollar range of revenue, where we'll either try to get acquired into a much larger organization, the kind of larger Meraki sizes and HP sized companies, or we're a critical mass where we can actually go out there. And my vision is direct. I'm so done with the traditional channel, and I think it's going away. And Amazon's kind of really set the tone for that. With Amazon Web Services, if you're setting up a company, you can slide the card and do it yourself. A partner can do it for you as well. And we feel we can follow the same model. We can sell directly to that person who has the branches, or a managed service provider who's taking it for them. They can use us and rebrand it as part of their service.
So you don't do any customization, actually?
We will. Yes, that's been customer-led. So I have some companies I'm talking to now. They like what we've got because it's simple, but they need three other features. And we absolutely will. And one of our differentiators is we have the ability to do a private cloud. Many of our competitors, the Meraki, Cisco's, HP's, Aerohive, they really don't want to get into that business. Whereas one of our differentiators, we can. So if you needed 8,000 devices because you're a telco in Turkey or Italy, we can actually take our whole environment, because it's all open source, we can bundle it up and we can put it on a set of servers anywhere.
So you're agnostic to AWS?
Correct. We use AWS as the hosting, but we're not married to the AWS tools that come with it. And that's an important trap not to fall into, because then you're stuck with AWS forever, but we're open source.
I'm still kind of thinking through how to phrase this question, so I might have to.
That sounds like a good question.
Ways, but my experience is a lot of the time the network goes down, it is not because of the router or the switch or whatever, but because of who the provider is. And you mentioned, as you were talking, you have the technology to kind of determine, you know, is it Comcast or is it the network? I guess my question is, you know, how do you deal with someone like Comcast? Like, obviously, it's $42,000 an hour. People are paying you for basically fixing that problem as quickly as possible. But a lot of the problem, I imagine, is outside of your control. So how do you mitigate that risk for your business?
Yeah, so when you're a small business like us, and you go tell Comcast that their service sucks because you were down for 2 hours, they're going to shrug their shoulders and say, so what? Okay. But in the urban areas, you do have other choices. And I think that would be the question, is you take your business to someone else, you can provide a better service. When you're a large company, you have more clout. So when you're starting to negotiate, and you know, the purchasing people, you know, that's where you can come in and say, listen, you know, we can't tolerate this any longer. You know, I'm paying for 100 megabits, at best I'm getting 70, and then three times a week, it's out for now. You know, So then you've got some leverage against them. The other thing you're going to start to see happening, because of this technology of software-defined WAN, which we don't do, is you're going to see that problem start to go away, because you'll have two connections, one from AT&T, one from Comcast. It gets to this box. So if one of them goes down, you still got a path out to the internet. So that's why the industry has invested so heavily on, rather than the MPLS, which is a very expensive dedicated service that can cost $5,000 to $10,000, you can now have a couple of cheap ones, and then you balance the traffic over it. So, you know, we will see less of those problems, but what we're doing is we're basically packing up the IT guy and putting in a box. So you don't have to pay someone $150 an hour to drive across town to go fix something that we can.
So I mean, it sounds like you're just not really worried about it because of the way you developed your product. But you know, as you get bigger, do you have plans to kind of develop a relationship with Comcast? I'm thinking back to a specific experience with me where my connection went down at my home office, and I'm one person, and I knew what the problem was, but I couldn't talk to the right person. Like, one of the backbone servers went down.
Right.
And I was like, just tell the guy that what's going on. It took I think it was 3 months before they fixed the damn issue, which is ridiculous. Like, I'm like, this is, I can't imagine that that was a normal situation, but it sounds like in your case, it doesn't really matter because I could potentially have Comcast and AT&T, which, you know, as a business might cost me $300 a month for both services. And as long as one's up, I'm good.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, so it's always a good, that's a good point to bring up. So we actually do think about our exit strategy, about where we want to go with this. And there are really two paths we see. One is that a Comcast, AT&T company would buy it because they want to extend their services beyond the traditional demarcation point. You know, the guy that says, well, anything in the house I can't touch. No, we would like to see an AT&T, a Comcast, and Comcast actually already made some moves in this direction with a similar company, where they're saying, you know what, we're going to provide Wi-Fi all the way into your service because we can actually connect your home to your office and you're on the same network because that's what this software and we can tell the technology can do. So that's kind of one exit is the big telcos, but they move so slow. I mean, they're like dinosaurs. You can call them up and a year later they go, oh yeah, we've been talking about that. And it's like, what, you know, really? I mean, the world's changed. They move very slowly, like Deutsche Telekom and those guys. The other area is the software-defined WAN companies, that they're figuring out this overlay for reduced cost and high availability, but they're realizing that they need to cover that last 50 meters into the building, and they can have that as part of their overall service. So they're kind of the two exits.
Thank you.
My question is, do you have any plans to move into, take that model and scale it down into the consumer market so that AT&T can compete with Comcast, particularly with bandwidth for delivering, you know, OTT, television and so forth. Right now, consumers, so I have one choice for bringing television into my home, and that's with Comcast. And I get, with that, 700 channels, of which I watch about 30 of them. So the future is going to be much different than that I see, and for companies like yours, it seems like there's a great opportunity to help out with maybe having redundant carriers into a household, so that you can take advantage of watching whatever show you want to watch, whatever football game you want to watch, whenever you want to watch it.
Yeah, I think it's a cost model with that redundancy for the home user. I don't know whether how the telcos kind of respond because they want to own you, as you said. They want to be able to tie you up and have this complete bundle that's going into your home. I'm sure there are some people that may have that desire for the redundancy, but I'm a little skeptical. What we have seen in the residential space is the Eero, the Luma. Those devices where you have the little pugs and you put them out and you get much better coverage in the home. And what they've done is incredibly simple. They simply had a radio and they've dedicated one radio to talking to the other access points so you get better quality coverage in the home. And then you can, you know, pause the internet for dinner and those kind of things, which I don't know if people really do that or not. But that's kind of the same kind of concept. So it's made my life a little easier when I'm talking about sort of the Wi-Fi solution, because a lot of people go, oh yeah, no, the Eero, I get it, because how simple and easy it is to manage and deploy. But in terms of that sort of level of redundancy, I'm not really sure I see it. I think we're going to see more in the home level, you know, fiber optic networks coming in, which will give greater capacity and probably some better redundancy. Does that, am I on the right track of your question?
It does, and I have a completely different question also.
Okay, sure.
So you're a medium-sized company, and you only have one carrier coming into your business. Mm-hmm. And so the network picks up that this, now your service has gone down for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. So do you have, I guess the question is, do you have multiple access points or reporting points for being able to reconfigure this network or maybe go to a secondary somehow? I don't know how you do that if you only have one carrier coming.
No, so a lot of the systems now, they have 3G backup connection, out-of-band systems. So you're exactly right. So of course, if the network's down, then how do you get to it to figure it out?
Right.
Okay, so there's Sierra Wireless and a lot of these other companies, they make a very low-cost SIM card that you can actually use within the device. So the device, we call it MOG, man on the ground, all this cloud stuff. I said, no, we want Indian demand on the ground. So we have this little box, and it has a SIM card in one side, so you can get to it over cellular data if everything else has gone wrong. It has power outlets, so you can actually turn devices on and off remotely. It has a PoE switch in, because you can turn the ports on and off remotely. And then you can actually, from your laptop, you can VPN into it as if you're actually on the network. So then you can get to all manner of other devices. I mean, it really is just like the IT tech with a suitcase, but he's sitting there 24/7 watching, and he leaps into action with the remote processor. So, you know, it'll say, okay, well, first we're going to reboot the modem. When that comes back up, we're going to put the router on, then we're going to bring the switches back. So it's this kind of configuration thing that you can run through before anyone's probably noticed.
Awesome.
Yeah. And the interesting thing is that all of those bits are out there today, but no one's put that all together yet. So we got to get there.
Any other questions?
Cool. Well, it's been fabulous talking to you. Thanks for your questions.